Sunday in which we recall the hope we have in Christ. The prophets of Israel all spoke of the coming of Christ, of how a Savior would be born, a king in the line of David. They spoke of how he would rule the world wisely and bless all the nations.
On Christmas Day, the Christ of our hope was born. On Good Friday, the Christ of our hope died. On Easter Day, the Christ of our hope rose from the dead. He then ascended into heaven. On the last day, the Christ of our hope will come again to establish his kingdom over all things on earth.
As the followers of Christ, we await his return. We light this candle to remember that as he came to us humbly in a manger at Bethlehem and gave light to the world, so he is coming again in power to deliver his people. We light this candle to remind us to be alert and to watch for his return. Let us pray.
Loving God, we thank you for the hope you give us. Help us to prepare our hearts for the Lord's coming. Bless our worship. Help us live holy and righteous lives. We ask in the name of the one Lord of heaven. Amen.
Surely the Lord is coming soon.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You may be kneeling. You may kneel. God spoke these words and said, I am the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods but me.
Lord, have mercy on us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not make for yourself any idol.
Lord, have mercy on us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain.
Lord, have mercy on us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Remember the Sabbath day, and keep it holy.
Lord, have mercy on us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Honor your father and mother.
Lord, have mercy on us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not murder.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not commit adultery.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not steal.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not bear false witnesses against your neighbor.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
You shall not covet.
Lord, have mercy on us, and write all these your laws in our hearts, we beseech you.
Dearly beloved in the Lord, if you intend to come to the holy communion of the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ, you must consider how St. Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, exhorts us all diligently to examine ourselves before we presume to eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For as the benefit is great, if we receive that holy sacrament with truly penitent hearts and a lively faith, spiritually eating the flesh of Christ and drinking his blood, so that we might be made one body with Christ and he so also is the danger great if we receive these gifts unworthily. For then we become guilty of profaning the body and blood of Christ our Savior, and we eat and drink to our own condemnation.
Therefore, judge yourself, lest you be judged by the Lord. First, examine your life by the rule of God's commandments. Wherever you have offended, either by thought, word, or deed, confess your sins to Almighty God, with the full intention to amend your life. Be ready to make restitution for all injuries and wrongs you have done to others, and also be ready to forgive others who have offended you. For otherwise, if you unworthily receive Holy Communion, you will increase your own condemnation. Therefore, repent of your sins, or else do not come to God's holy table.
If you have come here today with a troubled conscience, and you need help and counsel, come see me or some other priest, and confess your sins that you may receive godly counsel, direction, and absolution. To do so will both satisfy your conscience and remove any scruples or doubt.
Above all, each of us should give humble and hearty thanks to God for the redemption of the world by the death and passion of our Savior Jesus Christ. He humbled himself, even to death on a cross, for us sinners who lay in darkness and in the shadow of death, that he might make us children of God and exalt us to everlasting life.
Because of his exceedingly great love for us, our Savior Jesus Christ has instituted and ordained these holy mysteries as pledges of his love, and for the continual remembrance of his death and passion, to our great and endless comfort.
To him, therefore, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, let us give continual thanks, as is our duty and our joy, submitting ourselves entirely to his holy will, and striving to serve him in holiness and righteousness all the days of our life. Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of God. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal through him who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated and attentive to the reading of God's word.
Testament reading for today is from Isaiah. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to our adversaries, and that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you mountain quaked at your presence. From of old, no one has heard or perceived by the ear. No eye has seen a God beside you who acts for those who wait for him. You meet him who joyfully works righteousness, those who remember you in your ways. Behold, you were angry and we sinned. In our sins we have been a long time, and how shall we be saved? We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like polluted garment. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. There is no one who calls upon your name, who rouses himself to take hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us, and have made us melt in the hand of your iniquities. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Be not so terribly angry, O Lord, and remember not our iniquity forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The song point for today is Psalm 80. We will pray this responding at the asterisk. Hear, O Shepherd of Israel, you that lead Joseph like a sheep.
Show yourself also, you that sit on the cherubim.
Before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh,
stir up your strength and come to help us.
Restore us again, O God.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be whole.
O Lord God of hosts,
how long will you be angry with your people in array?
You feed them with the bread of tears,
and give them plenteous tears to drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbors,
and our enemies laugh us to scorn.
Restore us again, O God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be whole.
The second reading is from the first letter to the Corinthians. Paul, called by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge, even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end. Guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "In those days after the tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away before all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Of that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Take heed, watch, for you do not know when the time will come. servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Watch, therefore, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at the cock crow, or in the morning. Lest he come suddenly and find you asleep, and what I say to you, I say to all, watch. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, always be acceptable in my sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. This seems like a rather strange first week of Advent, because normally you hear banging and rustling and maybe a vacuum cleaner, but people are packing things up from the crest, and it's people are walking in and out. You hear this rumble next door. It's almost like this is an added-on thing we kind of do while they're cleaning up in there, because it's all going to be packed up, shipped off to the next church. But this year was different. We did. That didn't mean we didn't work. Didn't mean that nobody wasn't involved. There was over 1,200 meals prepared, packaged, and delivered from here this week. I have no idea how many people actually were involved in that. I was able to kind of just enjoy not being in the middle of that, and so it all got done, and I'm really pleased. And I think that what we accomplished was rather remarkable. I have no idea what the crest is going to look like next year, but if they're back to having 30 guys live with us for a week, we'll roll up our sleeves and do what we've been called to do. Also, if you've noticed when you were walking in today or as you walk out, the Christmas tree, the angel tree, is covered with stars. All the stars are one of the children that we are taking care of this year. The names have already been selected, gifts have already been buying and stuff, but it's a visual representation of what we've done, what you've done for others at the beginning of the season. And that's really great. I'm proud of you. We did more this year than last year. And I think every year we participated in Angel Tree, we've done just a little bit more. And that whole idea of looking out and watching out for others, I think is just marvelous, especially this time of year, you know. So I hope you enjoy the colors and the season and the things are changing, and it's Advent. Advent's something you don't really celebrate. Advent, it's an event. It is something that you observe by living it and doing it. You know, it's something that you do. You prepare. You start shifting your thinking. You get ready. And really, the gospel readings, and like I've told you this last couple weeks, the readings sound really dire. And if you think about it for a moment, this whole idea of encountering God in the flesh, or just encountering God, it's a big thing. It's not just this little baby that's slipping into the world. It's not just the beginning of the story here where he comes all sweet and mild, although that's a part of it. That tenderness and that love is a part of it. But encountering and meeting and living and touching God himself, God being revealed. You think about it, if he is really God, it should change us. And we would be wise to take some time and prepare for that encounter. It would be wise and behoove us to ready ourselves for that encounter. If I was going to meet somebody important, or even if I was, when Nancy and I was dating, you know, I made sure my hair was cut, I made sure I smelled good, I had a shave, I put on my best foot forward.
What hair?
Well, I used to have hair that I would comb, you know. But I mean, those were the things that I did because I prepared. I got ready for that time. And so we ought to do the same for the Lord. So Advent has always been kind of like a mini Lent. That's why we started with the exhortation. That's why we started with the penitential order today. And it seems a little backwards. we read the Decalogue and we just kind of stretched all that out to set our hearts and to set our focus in the direction it's supposed to go. It isn't, Advent isn't this celebration that we're supposed to party through. It is this time of reflection and renewal and movement. And you get that with today's gospel, and the gospel when Jesus is talking to the disciples, and the disciples, what he's doing is answering their question. He is answering their question of when. When will this day be? And so he tells them certain things, and he comes up in the middle of this, but you got like in these days, or that's sort of kind of shorthand for Mark and for others, or in those days of the day of the Lord. It is in the day of the Lord, then, you know, you get this idea of something's happening and moving. After suffering, the sun will be dark, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will be fallen from heaven, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. Quoting Old Testament, but he's starting to put in a poetic language for the disciples there to kind of wrestle with and say, this is just not bumping into your neighbor somewhere. This is something big, and it's going to shake the heavens, and it's going to shake the earth, and everything that we thought we knew was solid and sure and you could count on, it's going to somehow be rattled and rolled, and you got to beware, you got to be careful. And then he looks at the disciples and he says a couple things that I think is really interesting. He goes, learn from the fig tree. Now, I've never seen a fig tree. I've eaten a couple figs here and there, but I've never really seen a tree. So I don't really know what they look like from season to season. And so growing up, I've always imagined a maple tree, an apple tree, any other kind of tree. Like we know this time of year, a good portion of us have spent time raking up those leaves because we've observed them and we've watched them and they're going into fall. And so the leaves fall. It's autumn. The leaves fall. But when spring comes, it's almost like you don't see it all over. You see the trees maybe bud, maybe you notice them one day, or maybe you haven't been paying attention, but you walk outside and suddenly there's stuff all over the tree. There's flowers all over the trees. Things are starting to grow again. Jesus is telling his disciples, he goes, watch this fig tree. If you can figure out this, you'll have an idea and you won't be caught unprepared. And then twice. Now, those of you who are parents, when you repeat things more than once, it's because you want your children to really understand what you're saying. And so Jesus looked at the disciples and told them, keep awake. Keep awake. That's hard to do sometimes. And I'm sure that even as he was saying that, he was flashing forward to the time, or I always flash forward to the time, because I've read the gospel of how they slept in Gethsemane when he was in his last and final hours, and when he's praying to God that this cup might pass from him, he looks at his disciples and says, tarry with me for an hour and pray, because the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Pray. And he goes and prays, and he turns around and comes back, and they are sleeping. In this moment, in this critical juncture, they're sleeping. To try to be alert, to try to see the signs so that we can stay awake, so that we can stay prepared, so that we can get ready and make sure that we don't miss what God is doing on the earth today requires some attention to detail. But that's difficult for us. Very difficult for us. I've been receiving to the e-edition of the daily newspaper, and I'll be truthful, well, you know me, you know. I get it not because I want to be caught up on the news, but there's this whole comic page that I think is fun, so I read the comics every day, and right next to the comics is our puzzles. There's crossword puzzles, and there's a Sudoku, and there's little word games and stuff. Crypt quote that Nancy and I have been working here of late, you know, I just kind of get my little brain working. But there's a little puzzle called Hocus Focus that I have been doing that since I was a child, and I found a new little fascination with it. But it points to, or because of it, it takes an advantage of a flaw in the way that our mind works. And it's also one of the reasons why it's difficult for us to observe a fig tree and see, or for us to stay awake. The little puzzle has two pictures, and you're supposed to notice six differences between them. Some of you may have worked one of these in a highlights for children at the doctor's office when you were growing up, or while you were there with your children, or while you're taking your grandchildren there, because they're fun little puzzles to do. You know? But it's got two little pictures, and there's six little differences, and you have to spot them. And I have looked, and I have looked and studied. I spent 5 and 10 and 15 minutes and not noticed the difference. Once I see it, once you find that difference, I can't unsee it. It's the biggest thing in the picture. Oh, that leg is bigger. Oh, there's collar is different. It's, oh, that ear is bigger, you know. But there's a thing that calls, because of the way our mind works, we have this, what they call change blindness, where we don't notice change. Our minds are basically lazy. So if there's something that you see over and over again, or something that you see, your mind will just take a picture of it and plug that in regardless of what's going on. That's why magicians are able to make large things disappear, or even small things disappear, right in front of your eyes. Because you're expecting to see something, your mind plugs it in that it's supposed to be there, and suddenly it's not. It's magic. No, it's just somebody taking advantage of the way that your mind works. Our mind works this way because there's so much information coming in all the time, it's got to take a shortcut. I also do this, they've done this, and they've done this with studies, to where or an individual will come up to a counter, like to check into a hotel or for a function or an event, and be talking to the individual. The individual will drop a pen, go below the counter, and they'll have somebody entirely different stand up and talk to the person. You would think, well, I'd see that. No, 90-some% of the people never notice they're talking to another person. They could have a different color shirt on. They could be taller. Most people, if they do notice a difference, blame it on themselves. Oh, I didn't notice his shirt was red. I didn't notice he was that tall. They never notice it's an entirely different person. It's just the way our mind works. Our mind doesn't expect, if somebody drops down, they come back up, they carry on a conversation with us, we expect it to be the same person. Sometimes it's not. So Jesus says, watch the fig tree, and we have a tendency not to see the changes. We do this here at church when we train acolytes, or when anybody that comes up to starts to work up front or to worship up here, we tell people, look, if you need something or if you have to walk away, just walk away. We've had acolytes walk out and get something we forgot and come back. Deacons walked out and back. I walked out and back. And most people never notice it. Why? Because it's not something we normally do. And if we don't draw attention to ourselves, if we just stand up and move, your mind is saying, well, he's always sitting there during this part. Or your mind is focused on the reading or something else that's going on. And so your mind just plugs in what else is supposed to be happening, even though it may not be. One of the reasons it's hard for us to notice change. We don't see always what God is doing in the world because of this way that we're almost programmed as people not to notice change. Our brains are kind of plugged in there that this is the way it's always been and it will never change. So we don't see God working in our hearts. We don't see God working in our lives. We don't see God working in the lives of our family, in our community, or in our nation because this is the way it's always been and it doesn't attract our attention. We don't see what he's doing. And that really, for the most part, is harmless. That really, for the most part, me being able, or the deacon to be able to go back out and get something we forgot and walk back in and nobody noticed, that doesn't hurt anybody. But if this happens when you're driving, if this happens when you're cutting vegetables or something, the effect that it could have could be dire. And so in spiritual matters, in spiritual things, that is attuned for us to, as Jesus said, keep awake and learn, which means we have to do a little practice, which means we have to do a little rethinking on how we see things. We have to search them out to see what God's doing. We have to put in a little extra effort to see beyond the headlines, to see beyond the things that are driving our attention or the things that they advertise to us and throw at us. We need to press it just a little bit closer to see what God is actually doing. It helps if we know him, have a sense of where his heart is. But it helps us to also pay attention to learn. So I kind of come up, I don't want to say there's tools. This isn't an ABC for everybody. There are things that I do when I solve, or when I try to solve, and I generally get five. You know, I five out of the six in between the changes, you know. There's things that I do, and the way that I do it that may or may not work for you. Things that I do to try to keep focused on the changes or the things that are going on that may or may not work for you. If you are baptized, if you spend time in the Word of God, if you spend time in prayer, if you're doing the office and following this flow and path of the church, that helps. It does. It really does. And if you're not doing those things and you want to see or you want to know, I would start there. But here's a couple little things also that I found useful that actually St. Paul talks about in the side glance way in the letter to the Corinthians. Paul's writing the letter to the Corinthians that we read this morning. That's chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. He's writing it to a church that's in trouble. He's writing it to a church, half the church is mad at him. Half the church isn't paying attention to him. They've got this kind of disagreement going on. They've got these problems going on. And these are people, I think if I remember my calendar right, I think Paul was there with them for about a year and a half, planning this church and working with these people and working day in their jobs together. I mean, he put a lot of time and effort into these people for them to suddenly be upset and frustrated and causing this much problem. But when he writes them, he gives, I think, a couple clues that if we look at might be good for us if we want to learn to watch the fig tree. And one of the first things he does in verse 4, and the first couple verses are an opening. You can look at your bulletin because it's there, or if you grab your Bible at home. But he starts in verse 4 and he goes, I give thanks to God for you. Now that's really easy when you're doing something well. When this week you have done well at McCrest, when you've done well with Angel Tree, when you've done well in keeping us, and when you do good, it's easy to thank God for you. When you don't do good, it's harder for us to thank God. But I think if we learn this thing about the people that are in our lives and the people in and around us, if we can start shifting the focus and start thanking God for putting them in our lives. Thank God for putting that person, with all their difficulty, in our lives. They're there for a reason. Our Father General in MSJ tells me all the time, because I need constant reminding of it, this was sent for the sanctification of your soul. So sometimes I need to learn to thank God for the tool that he has placed in my life for the sanctification of my soul. But when I start doing that, it takes the focus off of me. I no longer see how short-sighted I am. I don't see or feel or mind the attention or the focus isn't here. It's outward. And if you want to see anything about the way God is working in the world, you've got to look somewhere else other than your own navel. You know what I mean? You just can't sit there and contemplate and look within you to find it. God works in time and in place and in people. And the best place
Thank God for the people that you agree with. Thank God for the people that you see God working in their lives. When you see God working in their lives, thank God for that. It's difficult for us to see the slow changes in our hearts. It's difficult for us when all we can focus on, because there's nothing to say that you're level. There's nothing to say you're right. You need compared to something else. Look at others. Look out. Thank God for others. The attitude of gratitude and that focus outwardly rather than inwardly will help us see how God is working and help us to determine the times and when that God is moving and changing and something that he's preparing us for. The second, and this is one of the things that it's not really like a point, but it's something I want you to remember and underline. He tells them, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened in you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift. One of the things that happens when we look at ourselves all the time, one of the things we tend to look at when we can't see the changes that we know should be there, is that we tend to think that we lack something. If I only had this, then I would see it. If I could only do this, then I would see it. If I was at church, if I knew as much as the priest, if I knew as much as the deacon, if I knew as much as, no. You are equipped with every spiritual gift God has to give to you. If you've been baptized, if you've been washed in the blood, if you have Christ within you and the Holy Spirit within you, what could you be lacking? You in Christ are seated at God's right hand in glory. What can you be lacking? But yet we do it all the time when we go to measure ourselves against others, or when we go to measure where we think we ought to be, and all we can see is our shortcomings, how we can't do this right, or how we always failed to do this, and how we can't do it. You lack nothing in God. Many of us are like, or I want you to consider in this, the prodigal son. The prodigal son was sitting in a pigsty with nothing, he thought. Sharing the slop of the pigs for food. The entire time, he was still a son. The entire time, he still was the son of a very wealthy man. All he needed to do was move and go home. It's not that he lacked anything. He was just in the wrong place. And I think sometimes that happens with us. It's not that we lack anything. God in us and him working in us and him being in us, we need to know that we don't lack anything. We may not be in the right spot, but we don't lack anything. There is no lack in God. And God's in you, the hope of glory. God's in you, providing and making it able. He wants you to see what he's doing. Doesn't he? And that brings us to the third point that Paul reminds the Corinthians of there at the beginning. He goes, God is faithful. God doesn't keep things hidden because he thinks it's a fun trick or a game to play with you. God wants to be known by you. He wants to bring glory to Christ. And if Christ is in you, you're a part of that glory. He wants that, and he wants you to know. He wants to show you, and he's faithful and will. We might need to move place. We might need to learn to thank God for others. But he is faithful and will preserve us and keep us in that day. When times are hard, when times are difficult, when all seems lost.
Amen. So let's this season, as we work along, as we plod along towards Christmas, not be discouraged. Help us to see those things that we're supposed to see and prepare. Take some time this month. Calm the hustle and the bustle and just prepare to meet Him at His coming. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please stand. Let us confess our faith in the words found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, the eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us kneel for prayer. The Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Share a sign of Christ's peace with your little family groups or accept this one. joy always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great glory to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and became subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. John the Apostle, and all your saints, into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see you, our Lord, face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood,
and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken. The body of Christ broken.
Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
May he whose second coming in power and great glory we await make you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Grant, Almighty God, that the words we have heard this day with our ears may be by your grace be grafted into our hearts, and that they may break forth in us the fruit of a righteous life to the honor and praise of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. I have an announcement before he dismisses you. You know, this is Advent, and it's Christmas, and December, and then January is the parish meeting. I'm not exactly sure exactly how we're going to do that this year. We'll figure out a way to do that at the parish meeting, but I'm here to inform you that there may be two openings on the vestry. We've worn them out. They can't do it anymore. No, not really. But there may be two openings, terms expiring, and so there's some options there. If you would like to become more involved in the day-to-day running of the church or the overall life of the church, let Greg know, or let I know, when we're together. Okay? Thank you.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.